This watch is actually very important. It's not spoken about enough, surprisingly. With a name like the Omega Aviator Chronograph Wristwatch 1915, I mean, who would have guessed? It's the most generic name you can possibly think of. But then all of a sudden you say the Lawrence of Arabia Omega. That gets your attention. Not only did this watch belong to T.E. Lawrence that he wore throughout his time during the Arabian campaign, but Omega decided to commemorate this piece and created, if I'm not mistaken, 18 of these pieces. One-to-one, accurate replicas of this watch, 105 years later. And what I thought I would do would be to talk about not only the watch, but the man himself, and just how these two play off each other. When we talk about famous watches, often enough in our pop culture, we hear about the Paul Newman Daytona, we hear about the Brando GMT, the Steve McQueen Submariner, the James Bond Omega Seamaster Professional. Maybe if we look further back at the Eisenhower Rolex or the Churchill Datejust, the Lawrence of Arabia Omega is often omitted, possibly because it's such an old watch and is pretty historic, but it needs to receive its attention. It needs the limelight. And as far as historical figures go, Thomas Edward Lawrence is quite the character to study. So, who was Thomas Edward Lawrence? I am by no means a historian, so I might get some of this wrong, but the basics are, he was born in England, and he loved the idea of knights and chivalry and the history of that time. He studied in Oxford and eventually decided to travel to Syria. He crossed the desert and really enjoyed that culture. He was really taken in by the life there, the space, the environment, the history. He studied as an archaeologist while there, writing a thesis, and it was around this time when the First World War began. Now, sadly, he couldn't enlist in the army because he was too short. So for a while, he laid dormant and remained in Arabia with nothing much to do. It so happened that the Ottoman Empire and their presence there was well known by the English. But as luck would have it, he would eventually become not only a spy and an informant, but someone who got to learn about the inner workings of the Ottoman Empire and their occupation of Arabia. And essentially, through his work, his insight, his partnership with the Arabic states, but also with the English, he was able to help free these Arabic states from Ottoman rule and essentially give these states their freedom. It's a fascinating story and one I highly recommend you look up, whether reading his book, The Seven Pillars of Wisdom, or watching the film with Peter O'Toole. The film really does capture that environment well. Of course, it's very dramatized and a lot of it isn't historically accurate. The watch that he wears in the film is not the correct watch. But it's an amazing piece of history, and it's a great story. Now, how he received this watch is quite an interesting one. It's still difficult to really ascertain just how it happened, but apparently this watch was supplied to France, and how this watch arrived to him is still quite the secret. No one really knows. This watch that he wore had its case back removed and replaced with another one, and for some unknown reason, the case back was engraved with the symbols of the Royal Air Force of the time, which was known as Air Ministry. We probably will never learn all of these little riddles behind the piece, but what we can understand is that it is a terrific watch for a few reasons. It is really a thing of beauty. The history of the wristlet began in the early 1900s, where there were essentially fashion accessories for females. It wasn't until the time of the First World War when men picked up these things and realized that having a watch on the wrist was a lot more easier to use and access instead of having to pick up a pocket watch every time they needed one. So these pieces of the time were essentially pocket watches with welded on lugs. You can see that these wires were just attached and they look very flimsy, dainty. You could say not really thought through very much. But what continually fascinates me about this period of watch is that even though it was in such an early development, there was a clear understanding that these pieces needed to be read easily. And in order to do that, they had to make them big. The numerals on the dial are so easy to see from a distance, which aids in that whole idea of it being a watch designed for a pilot. The crown is essentially the start of an onion crown. And at first glance, you might not believe, but it is in fact a chronograph. It doesn't have a start, stop, and reset button. It has a single button at the base of the case, at the 6 o'clock position. And then you notice the subdials. On the left, 60-second running time. On the right, a 15-minute totalizer. Extremely basic. Very rudimentary for its time, but it served its purpose. What's interesting is just how they used colors and balance and line weights with these pieces. You can see that it is very old-fashioned. that the styling is not exactly up to par with what we know today, but some of its influences have been translated through to modern pieces. I think of the Pilot's Calatrava, for example, from Patek Philippe, uses similar cues in a few places. It's great seeing the red accents on the dial, how it contrasts with the heat-blued hands, then how the heaviness of the line weight balances the numerals on the dial. Notice how there's almost a three-dimensional quality to the print. I also enjoy seeing how rudimentary this watch looks, how there was no clear thought about stitching, and to make it robust and able to endure more pressure and strain, they just decided to include three rivets on the strap to keep it together. Rudimentary, but surprisingly functional. And then we see how the use of rivets translated through all the way up until the Second World War, when we saw German aviation watches just the same. The movement in this watch is a thing of beauty, and I hope you're seeing the comparison between the new watch and the original, side by side. Omega went to painstaking lengths to recreate the movement to the T, not only mirroring the engraving, the stylized Omega logo at the time, but also modernizing it in a few ways, adding the artificial rubies. I'm sure they invested a lot of time and thought into just how the materials would work in the modern era. But they went to the lengths to mimic every single component. And since they only made 18 of these watches, you can imagine that they demanded a very high price. For your reference, the movement in this watch is the CHRO. And it's very important because Omega created this movement, and this original caliber was used for a long time, by many different squadrons especially. Now the watch itself, if it was to represent a character, I don't think we could really see Lawrence of Arabia wearing this watch. It doesn't have the same kind of audacity that you would expect a character to wear, if you know what I mean. There was no real pop culture or status back then. These watches were very much tools, and there was still no idea or understanding about what they were. The wristlet or wristwatch had just become mainstream and used by men for the first time. So of course, even back then, it was a working prototype, but it is a beautiful thing, especially when you get to see how the process of recreating this watch was achieved. The hand-painted enamel dials, every single component scrutinized and remanufactured, the correct materials. What is interesting is that the original watch wasn't made of stainless steel or white gold. It was in fact solid silver. And if I can find some great references of the original watch, you can see that it has patina that's developed over time. So when this watch was re-released as a series of 18, people were surprised. It's a very interesting bit of history. I was fascinated because I had studied up on the original many years ago, and seeing just how well Omega managed to replicate it is quite commendable. And of course, it came with a great box and presentation system. I'm sure all of these watches are accounted for and left in safes somewhere around the world. But it's a great piece of history, one that isn't spoken about at all, as far as I know. This specific Omega with a fascinating caliber, a single pusher chronograph that was made very popular in the time. The model itself looks like a glorified pocket watch with wire lugs to hold it together. It looks very rudimentary. Quickly assembled, we could even say. But even still, this being a military-issued watch, essentially, it still looks beautiful. Functional, efficient, fashionable for the time. And it goes to show that fashion, function, style, and utility can be combined into something extremely effective. Do we call this watch dated? Absolutely. It's over 100 years old at this point. But we can also say that its components, its aesthetics, the hidden details, were translated into all the Pilot's watches that we would know many years later, and the watches that we still see today. And as far as history goes, it is quite a time capsule, transporting you back to the time when there was no clear understanding about what a wristwatch was, just how effective it could be, and where its real history lied. And finally, most importantly, how a watch like this would develop and become so instrumental as a utility for years to come.